All right, we are continuing on June 4, 2016. We did Daniel 1, Daniel 2, and now we're doing Daniel 3. All right, before we do this, we should have a little bit of a summary of the things that we did last few weeks, Daniel 1 and 2, before we go to Daniel 3. Okay, so let's see. Let me go to the summaries that we've had before. Remember Daniel 1? Yeah, Daniel 1. If you were to summarize Daniel 1, how would you summarize it? Yeah, it's a message. How is the story of Daniel 1 the first angel's message? How is it the first angel's message? Remember what the first angel's message is?
Fear God.
Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of judgment is come. Now, how is Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego fearing God, for the hour of their judgment is come? How are they?
They're trying
Daniel 2 is bowing down.
Yeah. It's the picture is right there.
Yeah,
how are they fearing God?
They did not eat the king's meat.
Right. They don't eat the king's, the Babylonian food and drinks. They don't want it. They don't want to defile themselves because they know that their judgment is about to come. When was their judgment come? Actually, 3 years after.
Oh, 3 years after.
3 years after. When they were brought to the king and they were found to be what?
Ten times wiser.
All right. So they fear God and they give glory to Him for the hour of His judgments. So the Daniel 1 is a story of first angel's message. Okay. All right. Okay, you got to be ready because I'm going to give you a pop quiz of Daniel 1. You see those pictures? There's how many people there? There's six.
Six, yeah.
Which one is Ashpenaz and who is he?
Ashpenaz is the one carrying, he's the master.
Which one is Ashpenaz?
The guy
pouring. Yeah, Ashpenaz. He's the master of the eunuchs, right? Yeah. And he decides that all of them are going to eat and drink the food of the king. Okay.
Are those four Hebrews good-looking?
Yeah, they were good-looking. All right. Yeah. All right. Who's Melzar?
The one
behind. Yeah.
The food bearer.
Right. Now how's the story again? What happened? Who's Melzar? What happened to Melzar? What happened to Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in relation to Melzar? You remember the story?
Yeah.
I'm being very picky, but you know, we gotta know this. Yeah, that Daniel said to Melzar, he's the one that takes care of the food. You know, prove us 10 days, right, to Melzar. So there's Ashpenaz and there's Melzar. All right? Okay. So since the story of Esther is a type of the story of Daniel, remember, right? Esther and Daniel are the same stories, right? Who does Ashpenaz typify in the story of Esther?
No.
Remember that remember Ashpenaz is the keeper of the eunuchs.
Yeah.
So who's the keeper of the virgins? No.
I see,
remember. Who's the keeper of the virgins?
Oh.
Hebrew virgins.
Right.
What was his name?
Who can get it? Starts with an H.
Haman?
No, not Haman. No, he's a keeper of the Haggai. Remember Haggai? Right. Now there's two of them. One is Haggai, is the keeper of the virgins before they go to the king. And when they're rejected, they go to the other house. Who's the keeper of that house? No. Remember? Shaz guys, right? Right. You know, just to make sure just keep your mind going. Okay. All right. What is the prophetic significance of the 10 days proofing time? The prophetic significance, you know. In other words, is that, you know, where is that on the timeline? For Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The 10 days proofing time, what is that? Is that, they're being tested, right? That's right. 9/11 until midnight, all right? What is the prophetic significance of the 3 years? For Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. What's the prophetic significance of the 3 years? Right, that's when they finish off their binding time and they end cry. Yeah, and they end at the midnight cry, right? Yeah, they end at the midnight cry, because at the end of midnight cry, what happens to them? They're going to be tested by the king and found to be 10 times wiser. Okay, this is another one. This may be a little difficult, right? What is Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego learning in the school of Babylon that is prophetically significant? What are they learning in the school of Babylon? Obviously, they had to go to school for 3 years, right? They had to learn. What were they learning that is prophetically significant? No, but it's sure they learn all kinds of things. It's science, the laws. They obviously learned, cuneiform.
Right,
it's increase in knowledge. Yeah, it's in a way it is an increase in knowledge. But what is it that is prophetically significant?
Language.
There you go. That's it.
Language.
The Chaldean language. Because. Yeah, because there's going to be a change in language. They have to understand Syriac language. And remember, we were studying the Syrian language and the Babylonian language comes down from the Akkadian language, right? Because that's the one of the most early nations that eventually passed their languages down. But that language, Akkadian language, Babylonian language, Syrian language, eventually is known as Aramaic. What's the significance of Aramaic? What's the significance of Aramaic language?
It's the language of the Bible.
Language.
It becomes the language of the entire Syria, Mesopotamia, and even Israel.
And Israel.
Okay.
Wasn't Aramaic the scroll?
Yeah. What languages were the Bible written in?
In Latin, Aramaic. One more.
It's not in Latin. Well, obviously, ancient Hebrew.
Aramaic and
Greek. Okay, the New Testament is written in what?
Greek.
In Greek. Is it regular Greek or, common Greek? I mean, people's Greek or like the language of the learner? It's not. It's the common Greek.
Yeah.
It's called Koine Greek. Uh-huh. Right, Koine. This is just for your knowledge, you know. Mm-hmm. But most of the Old Testament is written in ancient Hebrew. Except for several parts of the Bible, which is written in Aramaic. And And Daniel 2 is written in Aramaic. All the way until Daniel 7 is written in Aramaic. There's also, I actually, you know, I started looking into this. Yeah, hey, wait a minute. You know what? There's parts of the Bible that's written in Aramaic.
Three scrolls.
The Dead Sea Scrolls.
Yeah, they're mostly Isaiah and what? They're in ancient Hebrew. Right. But Daniel 2 to Daniel 7 is written in Aramaic. Ezra, part of Ezra is written in Aramaic. Yeah. Okay. So what they were learning is the language of Aramaic, because that was the language, you know. So when I said Akkadian before, that's the original language. Eventually at that time it became Aramaic. And it got brought, it was taken into Israel, and eventually the Israelites, they spoke Aramaic. Right. Okay. All right. Now the wording is here in Daniel 8 verse 23. Can somebody get Daniel 8 verse 23? They had to learn a different language. What is that different language? Literally, can somebody read Daniel 8 verse 23?
At the time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences, and up.
All right. We know this is Rome, right? Daniel 8, you go back a little bit, and the rough goat and the he-goat, and the four kingdoms, and there's going to be after that, after Greece comes, another kingdom. And this king, this kingdom has a king, and this king understands dark sentences. What is dark sentences?
Actually,
it's actually Latin. Absolutely. It's absolutely Latin. Because what? Why is it Latin? Look at Deuteronomy 28 verse 49. Deuteronomy 28 verse 49. Who Moses already predicted that they are going to be conquered by a kingdom. All right, Deuteronomy 28:49.
The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand.
All right, so that's it, right? So dark sentences is the same as the tongue that thou shalt not understand. Is the Roman language, and Roman language is Latin.
Latin.
Right. They don't understand Latin. All right. Okay, now go to Daniel 2, verse 21 and 22. We're doing this a little bit different because I just added it this morning. Yeah. Yeah. What does it mean for Daniel to study Aramaic, to study the Chaldean language, to study Syriac? Right. Daniel 2, 21 and 22.
He changeth the times and the seasons to the king, up king. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them. What is in the darkness?
Right. So prophetically, the language is that is not understood is what? That is understood by only those who, you know, have the spirit of the holy gods. The Babylonians, when they look at Daniel, they said, well, you understand a different language. Mm-hmm. You, because you have the spirit of the holy gods. We'll do that in Daniel 4. Mm-hmm. They actually understand that he has the spirit of the holy gods and he can interpret dreams. And the dreams are the secret things. The secret things that are revealed is the things that you don't understand and written in a different language. Mm-hmm. Because later on, what's going to happen when Daniel, at the end of the Babylonian kingdom, goes in front of the king and reads what? Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin. Right? Now, they can read it, but it says that the king can read it, but what it really means is the king can read it, but he doesn't understand it. So it's like a different language. So Daniel...
Is that a Chaldean language?
Yeah, it actually is. But they can read it, but they don't understand it, right? And under it, so it means that during the time that Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went to Babylon, it was for them to understand the language of Babylonian. But what does that mean prophetically? Sure, that means it means that he's learning Aramaic or Babylonian. Prophetically, it means that he's learning prophecy, so that he can interpret prophecy. That's basic.
They spoke Aramaic because that was their language.
Yeah.
Which was the
But they brought the Babylonian language back with them during the time of Nehemiah and Ezra. That's when they that's when they changed their language into Aramaic. Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. But what prophetically it means that Daniel was learning prophecy. That's basically it. So for us,
for
you
us
know,
too,
that's why it is us. That's why it is exactly for us.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to, when we say we're learning a different language, we're learning prophecy. Because prophecy is a different language.
Right? Yeah, nobody can understand.
Right.
You don't get understanding.
What's the difference? What's the difference between the prophecy that's being done right now in spiritual Israel compared to the prophecy that we're doing now?
Uh-huh.
It's a different language, right?
Right?
Why is it different? We're doing line upon line.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It's a different language, you know. They don't understand it. Yeah, people are not going to understand it. Okay. All right. What about Daniel 2? All right. It's the second angel's message, right? Second angel's message is Babylon is fallen, right? The head is what? That's Babylon.
Yeah.
So Daniel is saying, you're going to fall, right? Because you are going to be replaced by an inferior kingdom, right? So Babylon is fallen, right? So this he's telling Nebuchadnezzar, Babylon is fallen, right? Okay, so I had a question here. But anyway, when you realize that the Daniel chapter 2 and until Daniel chapter 7 is written in the Aramaic language,
yeah.
Right? Ezra 4:7, from 4:8 up until Ezra 6:18 is written in Aramaic also. It's the Syrian language. Yeah. Okay. All right. The New Testament is written in Koine Greek. All right. From Daniel 2, who's Arioch? This is a pop quiz. Who's Arioch? He's the messenger, but he's the captain of King's Guard. What did he do?
He got her all the
perceived.
Yeah, he perceived, and he brought the decree to Daniel, because Daniel didn't know about the decree.
Right.
So he was the one that introduced the decree in haste, right? The decree was given in haste, and Daniel said, why is the decree given in haste? So that was brought by Arioch, right? And then Arioch brought Daniel, because he know Daniel knows how to interpret dreams, and bring it to the king in haste also. So remember that. So that's Arioch. Okay. So who's Arioch in the story of Esther? Okay. No. Before you answer, you got to think about it really closely. Who's Arioch in the story of Esther? Remember, Arioch is the one that brings the knowledge of the decree
to Daniel.
Okay? Who brings the knowledge of the decree? Because Esther didn't know about the decree. No, Mordecai, he says, oh, and he shout in a loud voice. And he had to, because Esther and Mordecai cannot talk to each other. They had to have an intermediary. What was his name? His name was Hattach. Hattach. Right? That is prophetically significant, because there's going to, you're right, they're going to receive it second hand, all right? It's going to be received second hand. All right. There's somebody who's going to be delivering the message. You know, these things are prophetically significant. All right. Okay. Now, this is something that we always know, but it's, I decided I'm just going to go over this, okay? And we'll see as we go later on why it is significant. Why? Yeah. Why did God choose Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to give the first, second, and second angel's message? And third angel's message? Why did God choose? Yeah. That's not the best way of asking it, you know? Why did he choose four slaves' boys to give the three angels' messages in Babylon? Why did he choose three slave boys? Yeah, that's the numbers is significant. Because
wise men.
Right, yeah. Why did they choose three slaves?
God.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, because they already know, they know God for sure. Right. Why did God not choose somebody else? In other words, who could he have chosen? Specifically, who could not? Who could not bring the gospel, the third angel message? The kings.
Yeah.
The leaders of Israel.
Leaders of Israel. Yeah.
This is actually something that you gotta, you know, you have to understand the concept.
Mm-hmm.
The three angels message, when it was given at the time of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, was not given to the leaders
the
to
leaders,
take to
the learned man.
Babylon.
They were bypassed.
They were bypassed, right? He had to pick
Young boys. Dear.
Right? Yeah. And how was these young boys trained?
By their mothers.
Right. Ellen White specifically said, was it in the schools?
No.
It was by their mothers. Yeah. Right. It's very, very important. Because, yeah.
Schooled.
Right. And obviously it was not, their leaders did not bring it to the Babylon, you know, that was who? Zedekiah, Jehoiachin, and Jehoiakim. Yeah, right? It's a very important point. The three angels' message were not taken to the world by the leaders. It's going to be taken by the boys who are taught by the... And then when the third angel's message is given at the time of when Jesus first came, who gave the first angel's message when Jesus first came?
John
the Baptist, right?
Yeah.
What did he say? Repent.
Repent
for the people. For the kingdom of God is at hand, right? Matthew 3 verse, what is that? Matthew 3 verse 2. Repent ye, for the kingdom of God is hand. Is that? That's the first angel's message, right? Right? And then, O generation of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come?
Yeah.
That's the first angel's message. Who gave that? John the Baptist. How was he prepared to give the first angel's message?
He
was in the wilderness. And who taught him? His mother also. Right? God, yeah, through nature. Right, but his mother. All right. Who gave the second angel's message? During the time of Jesus. How? Remember how? How did he give the second angel's message? What is the second angel's message? Babylon is fallen? It's fallen. So what is the second angel's message when Jesus came the first time? Jerusalem is fallen? It's fallen, right? And what do you have to do when Jerusalem is fallen? It's fallen. Run to the mountains, right? Right? That's in Luke 21, right? When Jerusalem is encompassed by armies, you have to flee to the mountains. How many times is it encompassed by armies? Two times, right? The first time it was encompassed was with? Cestius, right? And the second time was? With Titus. Between the first and the second time, that's the time to flee. So Jerusalem is fallen. What do you have to do? Run to the mountain. Is that the second angel's message? Yeah, Babylon has fallen. It's fallen. Right. And who taught Jesus how and prepared him to give the second angel's message? His mother. Right. Why was it that they did not go to the schools of the rabbinical schools according to Desire of Ages 101? Because the training of the rabbinical schools would have unfitted him for his work. And his work was to preach the three angels' message. Right? The rabbinical schools would have unfitted him. We know all this, right? Yeah. But just put it all together here. The story of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, same thing like John the Baptist. Right. So what will happen before Jesus comes the second time? The same thing. Because the principles of God's dealing with men are ever the same. That's in Great Controversy 343. So, now we get to the third angel's message. All right. Daniel 3 verse 1. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits. How many? 60 cubits. And the breadth thereof, 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. What's the third angel's message? If any man, what?
Worship
the beast and his image. So is that the third angel's message right there?
Yeah.
Remember, so if you have a little trouble for remembering what the first, second, and third angel's message, remember the story of Daniel, right? Yeah, the first three books right there, right? Okay, he made an image of gold, 60 cubits. And 6 cubits breadth. All right. This is a cubit, right? It's 1 cubit. About. I have a. Yeah. Prophets and Kings. The words, "Thou art this head of gold," has made a deep impression upon the ruler's mind. The wise men of his realm, taking advantage of this and his return to idolatry, propose that he make an image similar to the one in his dream. So that image of gold is a type of the image that he saw in his dream, right? But it's the his Yeah, it's actually his assistants, or what did he say? The wise men, right? The wise men who are really foolish, right? Who says, "Oh, you have to make a type of that," right? Pleased with the flattering suggestion, he determined to carry it out and go even further. Instead of reproducing the image as he has seen it, he would excel the original. His image should not deteriorate in value from the head to the feet, but should be entirely of gold. Symbolic throughout Babylon as an eternal, indestructible, all-powerful kingdom, which should break in pieces all other kingdoms and stand forever. So he wanted to make a type. And this is the image of the beast. This is the third angel's message, right? Okay. All right. When was the third angel's message given? Prophetically. When was it given? No, on the timeline, you know. No, not Sunday law. At the Sunday law, it's empowered. But when is it first given?
Midnight cry.
Because what happens at the midnight cry? The image of the beast is first set up, right? So the image of the beast is first set up. The first Sunday laws is at the midnight cry. This is when the image of the beast is set up. But when do you have to bow down to it? After it's set up, right? So you have to set it up first, and then you have to make people bow down to it, right? So it's set up before the Sunday law, right? All right.
There'll be no Sunday.
Well, that's right. You have to set up the image first.
Yeah.
Right. It's very, very important. From the treasures... Oh, let me get my... Okay. From the treasures obtained in war... He obtained it in war. He made a golden image to represent the one that he had seen in his dream. setting up in the plain of Dura and commanding all the rulers and the people to worship it on pain of death. Right? First he had to set it up, then he had to make, then later on, make people bow down to it. The statue was about 90 feet in height and 9 in breadth. So according to Ellen White, one cubit is approximately 18, yeah. Because it's different sometimes. Some people say it's 15, 20, 21, 22, but according to Ellen White, you know, it's about 18. Mm-hmm. Some people use different numbers. Okay. When you... So this is what he actually set up. Spiritually, does Babylon last all the way till the end of time? Spiritually. That's right. We studied last week, right? Babylon goes all the way until the end time. So spiritually, Nebuchadnezzar's wish came true. It's going to come true, right? Think about it. Right? But because who is Babylon in the end of time? Rome. Rome again. All the way to the end, right? It's going to be Rome. So actually, this is actually true too. Because Babylon is going to go all the way until the end, until he's going to be smitten by a rock that is carved without man's hands. Right? Okay. All right. Manuscript Release, Volume 13. This is what will be sure to occur when the law of God is made void by a national act. When Sunday is exalted and sustained by law, then the principle that actuates the people of God will be made manifest, as the principle of the three Hebrews was made manifest when Nebuchadnezzar commanded them to worship the golden image in the plain of Dura. We can see what our duty is when the truth is overborne by falsehood. What is Ellen White saying? What is she saying? That the worship of the image of the beast is what? Is the Sunday law, right? So when you're forced to worship, so when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego has to bow down to the image, that is the Sunday law. When you light up those lines, it's going to be Sunday law. This is the thing that I was discussing with Jackie before. Where is it in the Bible, literally, that is written down that there is going to be a Sunday law before Jesus comes the second time? Where is it in the Bible? That is written in the Bible, there is going to be a Sunday law before Jesus comes. Where is it written in the Bible? Think about it. Where is it written in the Bible specifically? With somebody is going to come to you. Do you, you're Seventh-day Adventist, do you believe there's going to be a Sunday law? Yeah. Where is it in the Bible that there's, in the Bible it says there is going to be a Sunday law before Jesus comes. Where is that? There's none. No, there's none. Specifically in one verse it says there's going to be a, you know, because the Sabbath is right there, you know, and Exodus, you know, you have to, the Sabbath is the, right, it's right there, Sabbath. So how do we understand that there's a Sunday law? How do we understand that there's a Sunday law? How does Adventists believe, you know, there's a lot of world religions, but how many of them believe that there's going to be Sunday law before Jesus comes? You know, I was thinking about this, you know, Adventists believe that. But it's not even said in the Bible. Literally, it doesn't say it. That's the same thing. That's right. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
So how do we know that there's going to be a Sunday law? Because we understand the dark sentences, right? We understand the prophecies. Yeah, we understand the Bible in symbols and parables, and then the secrets that are written in foreign languages. Yeah, right? Okay. So, I'm going to ask you, each one of you, all right? Think of a story in the Bible that points to the Sunday law. We already given one right here. This is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. Okay, that's one. All right. One by one. I want to think one by one. Give me a story. You know, which is the story of Esther? Where in the story of Esther does it say it's the Sunday law?
My people perish.
No, that's the midnight cry. Midnight. When is it?
They were supposed to be killed.
The decree that they will be killed.
That's when Haman was hung. When the Jews that they were going to be killed, that's the death decree. Right? When Haman was hung? Okay, that's one. All right. Somebody else. Uncle Uchak, think of another story that shows that there's going to be Sunday law. There's so many, actually. But, you know, we just have to think about it. I'm just making you so you think about it. Where in the Bible where it says there's going to be Sunday law? Just by, you know.
Their story.
By the secrets. We're talking about deep secrets and foreign language now.
Joseph.
Yeah. When is the story of Joseph?
When is the Sunday law?
Yeah, when is the story of the Sunday law at the time of Joseph?
The famine time.
Right? When's where specifically?
They are going to be.
Yeah, almost there. When the brothers come. When the family comes, right? When they join.
Noah.
When at Noah. No, that's the rain.
Door closes.
The rain. Okay, you got one more.
Everyone.
You got Uncle Pete. You got to think of one. Where is the story of the Sunday law in the Bible? Remember a story. The story of Lot. Well, actually, you know, that's a little tricky, because there's two doors that closes at the time of Lot. But those two doors is a midnight and a midnight cry, so it's not the Sunday law. All right. Yeah. Uncle Pete, think of a story that points to the Sunday law. You know, I was thinking about this. Oh, this is a good exercise. Because, you know, if somebody asks you about Trinity, you get back with them with this one. Right? Oh, where's the Trinity in the Bible? You know, it's not in the Bible. Oh, yeah? Where? The Sunday law is not in the Bible either? You believe in the Sunday law, right? Where is it in the Bible?
Balaam.
All right, okay. All right, Uncle Pete, where is the Sunday law on the story of Balaam? How many times did they meet the angel? Right. Which one is at the Sunday law?
Crushing at the
foot. No, no. Crushing at the foot is what? Crushing foot as a midnight cry. When he starts speaking. Yeah, when he falls down and starts speaking, right? Balaam. The donkey, yeah. Yeah, he wants to hit. Okay, Auntie Doreen, one more. Who starts speaking? Who starts to speak? Who was dumb and cannot speak, and suddenly he speaks at the Sunday law?
Zacharias,
right. Yeah, Zacharias. What about the fall of Jericho?
Oh, yeah.
Remember? Fall of Jericho, that's Sunday law. Right?
What about Naomi and
Ruth
and Naomi, actually, that's true.
Yes.
That's when Ruth marries Boaz. Yeah, that's at the Sunday law. Okay, what about, all right, we got this one.
What about Saul?
Oh, yeah, Saul. Oh, yeah, that's very obvious. King of when was that? When King Saul, all right. King Saul. Well, it's got to be when he dies. I have to go back and look at that.
Door was closed.
Yeah, because he went to the Endor.
Well,
that's 9/11.
Yeah, the witches.
Yeah, he's got to die at the. Well, you know, I think that comes into kind of ties into the story of David, because David was anointed. David's fourth anointing, when he anointed himself.
Yeah.
All right, and that's at the Sunday law. All right. One more. when Jonah preaches to the Ninevites,
oh.
Right?
Yes.
And they all get converted.
Yes.
That's when the Nethinim comes in, right? Because they all get converted,
yes.
Right? Yeah, that's when they come in. Right? That's the Sunday law. That's when the Nethinim come in, the 11th hour workers come in. There's so many, you know? You just go over and over. Yeah. But just remember, you know, this may be a useful pocket strategy when somebody says, you know, not that we want you to argue, but a lot of people, there are people that say, where is it? Where's the Sunday law in the Bible? It never says it. Okay. All right. Daniel 3, verse 2 to 3. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather. Oh, is there a gathering? Is that significant? Yeah. Because there's going to be a gathering, right? The virgins are gathered, right? Now everybody has to be gathered. Who are gathered? The princes, governors, captains, judges, treasurers, counselors, sheriffs, rulers of the provinces, to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar king had set up. Then the princes, governors. Why does the Bible do this? Is this significant?
Oh yeah.
Oh, yeah. Princes, governors, captains, judges, treasurers, counselors, sheriffs, rulers of provinces were gathered again. How many were gathered? How many groups of people were gathered?
Eight.
There's Ut. And how many times were these eight groups mentioned?
Twice.
Twice. Right. Now, what's the significance of eight?
Sunday.
There you
Sunday.
Go. Right. This is pointing to the Sunday, because Jesus was risen up on the eighth day, right? Because Sunday is the eighth day. The union of church and state.
Yeah.
How do you get eight? Well, there's eight kings, but Sunday law.
You got the United Nations, you got the decree in there, you know. Point to me. We're going to have a Sunday law.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. It's always pointing to the Sunday law. Okay, what about 8 and 8? 8 is the priests are purified for 8 days, and the Levites are purified for 8 days, right?
Mm-hmm.
What does 16 mean? Is there a significance to 16? 8 and 8?
Yes.
Yeah. What is the significance of 16? The 16 in the days of the feasts. What's the 16th day of the first month?
Another celebration, right?
Yeah, when you're the wave
chief.
When is the wave sheaf?
The
at the Sunday law. Right? Yeah. Okay.
Are there 16 prophets in the
book? Oh, wow. I don't know about that. Yeah. So that's when they're gathered, and they are being prepared for the Sunday law here. All right? So, where is this? Okay. We know this is Sunday law. This is when they have to go and face the fiery furnace, right? If they don't bow down, right? This is the Sunday law. When is the image set up then?
Midnight.
Right, midnight cry, right? So this is when they're gathered. So the image of the beast has to be set up here, the midnight cry. So the image is set up and they're gathered, and there's eight groups of people two times, which is pointing to here, right? You know, they're pointing to here, okay, because these people are being gathered so that they can later on bow down, right, at the time it was set up. Okay. Yeah, there will be starting of a Sunday laws will start. Sunday laws will start here. All right. Okay. I don't want to get sidetracked here, but who's going to buy in and say, well, it's okay for you to keep Sunday here?
Who else?
Mm-hmm. Okay. They say it's okay. It's not good that you have to keep Sabbath, but it's okay to keep Sunday too, right? It's gonna happen right there, officially. All right, Daniel 3, verse 4 to 7. Then a herald cried aloud. Now, he's crying aloud is what? There's a loud cry right there. Now, the loud cry can happen at the midnight, or a midnight cry too. But midnight cry and Sunday law, right? Because the midnight cry swells to a loud cry. Right, cry. To you it is commanded. What's commanded? A decree. O people, nations, and languages. Oh. At that time, when you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer. And all kinds of music. All right. Is this significant? It is. Everything is significant. Okay. How many music instruments are there?
Six.
Six. All right. What's the significance of six? All right. You know, this is kind of tough. And all kinds of music. Ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. So it says, when the six instruments, there's a herald. This is not the Sunday law yet. It's still at the midnight cry. There's gonna be a loud cry, right? Midnight cry, loud cry, right? And it says, there's a decree, right? That midnight cry, there's going to be decree. Sunday laws is going to start. But you will not have to face death until Sunday law. Right? There's going to be decree. And it says, in the future, right? Is it in the future or at that time? In the future, when you hear, at that time, when you hear the sound of a cornet, all this music. So this music will play at the Sunday law. Correct? Mm-hmm. Right. And whosoever falleth not down and worship shall the same hour. So there's the same hour. At that same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fire furnace.
And in the same time that the music.
The same hour. Yeah. Okay. Same hour? Is that 1 hour or is that one moment? Is it one moment or is it at? It's a period of time or is it a point in time? It's got to be a period in time. Yeah. Be cast into the midst of a burning fire furnace. Therefore, at that time when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery. How many now?
Five.
Yeah. Why was there six here and now there's five here? All the people, the nations, and the language fell down and worshipped. Oh, okay. So when the music played, they fell down and worshipped. Okay. Now this is verse 5. This is verse 7. Verse 5 has 6 music instruments. Verse 7 has 5 music instruments. Look at verse 10. Can you go to Daniel 3, verse 10? How many musical instruments are playing there? Six.
Six.
What about verse 15? Six. Why is there only 5 here?
We forgot the
You know, this is the tough one when they were doing the School of Prophets. We can't figure this out. Why is there only 5 and the rest are 6? It's mentioned. But this is all mentioning to the one episode of the Sunday law, right? When you hear the music plays, when you hear these musical instruments play, you have to bow down, right? But why is there, so what's the significance of dulcimer? Find out what dulcimer means.
Dulcimer,
we looked this up last time, we forgot.
Yeah, dulcimer is a bagpipe. Ancient time
in the Right, remember that dulcimer thing? That's a modern dulcimer. But in the old days, it's a bagpipe. But it also means symphony or singing. Something about singing. There's going to be singing something about singing at the Sunday law. Is there singing at the Sunday law? All right. All right, there's going to be a singing, all right? We'll go there. This is the Sunday law, right? So you gather, you set up, you gather, and there's eight groups. All right? So you set up the image right there. Image to the beast is set up right there. And then there's a loud cry, and there's a decree. And then that's when the music plays. When your music plays, what do you have to do? You have to worship the image, right? Right here. Okay. But for some reason, dulcimer is not mentioned. And dulcimer can mean bagpipe, but it also means singing. Now when we say there's a singing for some reason at the Sunday law. Now this is the same hour. This is the hour right here. Because remember, who's given for 1 hour? The America is given to the... No, wait a minute. Yeah. The United Nations is given to the papacy for 1 hour, right? This is 1 hour right here. Right? This is the hour. Okay. Do you remember that? Okay, we'll go to the singing. Who's singing? 2 Chronicles 29. And he set the Levites in the house of David with cymbals, psalteries, and harps, according to the commandment of David and the Gad, the king's seer, and Nathan the prophet. So was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets, and the Levites stood with instruments of David, priests, and trumpets. So the Levites had cymbals, psalteries, and harps. Levites and the priests had the trumpets. And Hezekiah commanded to offer the burnt offering, and when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began with trumpets and instrument ordained by the David, king of Israel. And all the congregation worshiped, and the singers sang, and the trumpeters sounded. Right? Go down here. Moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing unto the Lord with the words of David and of Asaph the seer. This is when the priests have been sanctified and they've cleansed the temple for 8 days. And after that, the Levites, they cleansed the courtyard for 8 days. At the end of those 16 days, then the Levites sing. And the 16th day, that's the Sunday law. So the Levites are going to sing and the Sunday law, right? Yeah, they're going to be lifted up. And they're going to proclaim to the world, you know, that's Levites are going to sing. Who else is going to sing at the Sunday law? Isaiah 23. And it shall come to pass in that day that Tyre shall be forgotten 70 years. Who's Tyre that's forgotten 70 years? According to the days of one king, after the end of the 70 years, shall Tyre sing as a harlot. Who's specifically, which Rome? That's papacy is going to be forgotten for 70 prophetic years. That's from what year to what year? 1798 until? To the Sunday law. America is going to be the ruler, and the papacy is going to be forgotten. But what's going to happen to the papacy at the Sunday law? She's going to start singing. What does it mean to sing as a harlot? She's going to be white. Why is she going to sing sweet melodies and sing many songs? That she may be what? Is the papacy going to start being remembered now?
Yes.
But what is she being remembered as? Yeah, right now he's a good guy.
Oh, yeah.
But what's going to happen at the Sunday law? Then they will know who the papacy really is. Because now he's going to make you what? Because the papacy make you worship. Yeah, against your conscience, right? There's no such thing as your conscience. The Pope already said, there's no such thing as your conscience. Your conscience ends, Right? Right? Because we will control your conscience. Right? And now the papacy will remember, be remembered. She's going to sing like a harlot. Right? At when? At the Sunday law. Right? So who's going to sing? The papacy is going to sing. There's going to be a singing there. Right?
So
that's
that means Levite's going to sing and papacy.
When the papacy sings, she's going to be remembered. Right? She's going to be remembered because she now is going to, when you remember, we did this before, she's going to remember her experiences. What were her experiences? Persecuting God's people. Right? She's going to start persecuting God's people. Throwing them into the fiery furnace. Right? That's going to be Sunday law. She's going to sing like a harlot. Right? For the Levites, they're going to be lifted up. Right? Because Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're going to be lifted up, right? Wait, but they're actually the 11th hour workers, but the Levites and the priests, they're going to be lifted up, and they are going to sing over their experiences to the whole world, right? Okay. Does that make sense now?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
It's a Sunday, Lord, that the singing happens.
Yeah, the singing happens. But prophetic singing, what does that mean? You know, it's different for whoever it is.
Yeah, yeah.
When Tyre sings, she is remembered for whoever she really is. Now, who's going to sing also? The economy. The ships of Tarshish did sing of Tyrus. Because Tyrus, of Tyrus in thy market, and thou wast replenished, and made very glorious in the midst of the sea. Thy rowers have brought thee into great waters. The east wind is going to be broken. So the economy is going to sing also at that time. Is why it's going to be broken. Because the east wind. There's going to be a lot of singing. At the Sunday law. Right?
Well, we're learning winking and singing.
Yeah, you know, this is, I'm telling you, this is secret language,
right?
Right? This is dark secrets. You cannot study like this. It's incredible. I'm just completely amazed that you can study this way, because you're not going to be able to know this if you just read and you don't do line upon line. Yeah. Wherefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. Oh, who are these? The accusers. There's going to be some accusers.
Of the Chaldean is the Jewish people?
No, that's the Babylonians. Yeah. But, all right. That's another, that's another study. But there's going to be accusers. Yeah, but who's gonna turn them into the Chaldeans, right? Yeah, the brethren is gonna turn them into the Chaldeans. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, has made a decree. Oh, remember that decree you already made? That every man should bow down to the music when the music starts and worship the golden image? Whoso falleth not down and worship, that he should be cast into the middle of the burning fiery furnace. So where are we now? Are we already at Sunday law, or we still have reached now? Hey, no, we're already at, yeah, because they're already bowing down now.
Oh, you're talking about that?
Yeah, this time right here. What about at this time? There's some accusers that says, wait a minute, king, didn't you make a decree?
Yeah.
These Jews, they did not bow down.
Sunday.
So where are we now? We're Sunday law now.
Sunday.
Right, yeah, we're at the Sunday law. Because these Jews, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they did not bow down. O king, have not regarded thee, they serve not thy gods. Right? Nor worship the golden image. This is one thing that really caught my attention. They serve not thy gods. Why did these Chaldeans call the gods of Nebuchadnezzar thy gods? And not only three. They have multiple. They have so many gods. They have like 20, 30 gods. It's a polytheistic religion. So many gods. Nor worship the golden image with the house set up. Meaning, this golden image represents thy gods. When they're worshiping this one god, they're worshiping all the gods of thy gods. Right? Right. Yeah. We, you know, when you look at this, you realize there's one golden image that represents the gods of the Babylonians. All right? This is in the British Museum. But these are the gods of, there's many gods of them. And the one, the most supreme are on the top. You know? There's the sun. Okay, where's the sun? The sun is this one. Okay, it's difficult for you to see, but we'll have a better representation of this. This is the sun, this is the moon, and this is the star. And this star is specifically the eight-sided star. Mm. Yeah, that's also used in occult. You know, the eight-sided star, for some reason, you know. I was just looking it up. Yeah. The Star of David has a six sides.
Six sides.
Yeah. The eight-sided star is actually occult. Yeah. Right. But this is the sun, the moon, and stars. There are many religions. I'm going to say the sun is the solar disk. All right. This is the sun. You see some rays coming out of it. Right. And it is represents Shamash. This is the moon. The moon represents Sin or Nina is the moon. And this is the eight-pointed star represents Ishtar. But they eventually kind of change, because as Medo-Persians came and the Greeks came and everybody, they kind of joined, and eventually they become Bel, Ishtar, and Tammuz. But at the top, there's always a triad of called the Great Triad. The Great Triad are three, and the three are the major ones, right? All right. You can see it here too. Here, that's Shamash, Sin, and Ishtar, right there. Yeah, that's the three. Mm-hmm. It already started. This has already started back then. They have their main gods are grouped into threes. Right. Okay. So there's the what? There's the accusers right here. They're accusers right at the Sunday law. And the Sunday law, what do they accuse these Hebrew boys of doing? They're not bowing down to the gods of Babylon. And one of the things that we realize, is it all about Sunday? No, it's not all about Sunday. Sunday is the manifestation of your love and that you believe in God, of the God of creation. But it's also about worshiping, whether you worship their gods or not, right? Because their gods is different than our God. It's very easy now. It's different. Their gods are different than ours. Okay. Isaiah 66. We sidetrack a little bit here. This is about the gods of Babylon. Now here is Isaiah talking. This is talking about the Babylonians, all right? That the Babylonians, they sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree. Tree is what? Supplied. Remember, a tree is supplied. Right? In the gardens behind one in the midst, eating swine flesh. Yeah, they're pork eaters. Yeah, they're pork eaters. The Babylonians are pork eaters. And the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together. They're all going to be consumed together. They that purify themselves in the garden behind one. And one is Ekad. You heard of people talking about Ekad? Ekad is the unity. A unity. When they say unity, is what? They right away they say, oh, you know what? It's plurality combined. But Ekad, actually, when you consider the majesty, the plurality of majesty, it's like it's a plural, right? When you consider somebody's majesty, it's plural, right? Yeah, you know, it's just not a singular. You know, when it's really grand, it's a plural. Mm-hmm. You know, your description is plural also, right? So in the gardens, where are the Babylonians? They're sanctifying and purifying themselves in the gardens behind one. There's one is this their triad of gods, the Ekad, the plurality that's in unity. Because Ekad is like united together. This is why people says, oh. Remember Deuteronomy 6:4?
Yeah.
Hear, O Israel. Hear, O Israel. What is hear, O Israel? The Lord our God is one God. One is what? Ekad. Here is Shamaz. Shamaz Israel. Yehovah Elohim Ekad Yehovah.
But it's a unity not of numbers.
That's the thing, right? It's the unity of it's unity kind of like in the description of majesty.
Yes. But
right.
Numbers.
Yeah, that's the biggest problem that people have. Mm-hmm. People put this in numbers. It's a unity of number. So they say, oh, you know what? It's plurality. I don't know how many. You know, seven, three sounds good. You know, so that's what they have. You know, when you start talking to people, they will make a big deal about this Ekad. Ekad is unity. When you think about unity, you're thinking about plurality combined into one, right? Right away. They said, oh, hear, O Israel, Shamaz Israel, Yehovah Elohim Ekad Yehovah. So Ekad, but Ekad it means united here. What is it that they're worshipping in their gardens? Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be a snare into the midst of thee. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. They're worshipping in their groves, which is their gardens. Mm-hmm. Their one in the midst is their altar. Right? Right. The gardens, what they're worshipping is in the gardens is their groves. In their groves, they have their altars. You have to break that. Because they're purifying themselves. This one is talking about their altar. Alright? Their Ekad. What about their altars? A people that provoketh me to anger continually to my face, that sacrifice in gardens, is talking about the Babylonians. They sacrifice in their gardens and burneth incense upon their altars of brick. The issue is that what do they offer their incense on? Altars of brick. Why is that significant? Why is altars of brick significant? You cannot offer your sacrifice and altars of brick. Why is that significant? That's true. But what is God's altar, the altar to God, how is it made?
It's natural stone.
Deuteronomy 27, 4-6, yeah. Therefore it shall be when ye be gone over Jordan, that ye shall set up these stones, which I command you this day, in Mount Ebal, and thou shalt plaster them with plaster. You still plaster them with plaster, but how do you make the... And there shalt thou build an altar, right? Altar unto the Lord thy God. An altar of what? Bricks?
Stones.
No. an altar of stones. And what's wrong? What are these stones? Thou shalt not lift up any iron tool upon them.
You cannot hew them.
You cannot cut them. They're just like these. Look at the stones. I think there's Abraham. Abraham is making these stones, his altar, just by stacking up whole stones, right? That's the difference between the brick, the altars of brick, and the altar of stones, right? These are chiseled, right? And
bricks are made of.
You shape it.
They
have that means was designed by God, not designed by man.
Right. So when you design it with your own hands, what is that? Your works.
Your works.
Right? Just like Cain and Abel.
Yeah.
Right? Abel, he gave his works, what? His fruits and vegetables. He wanted to sacrifice that to the Lord. That's his works. You cannot sacrifice that. Right? Okay. Genesis 11. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. This is the first time that Babel is mentioned in the Bible. So this is very significant. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar. Right? That's the land of Shinar. And they dwelt there. And they said one to another, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and slime, which is mortar, right? With the plaster, right? Right. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower. What is a city and a tower? This is the city, and that's the tower. The tower is the what? The ziggurat, right? Don't they have cigarettes in Mesopotamia?
Mesopotamia.
Right. This is their city. This is the, remember, that's the gate of Ishtar. But this is their city and that's their cigarette. The city is a what? Prophetically, what is a city? A state. What is a tower? A church. Let us make a church and state, right? That is made out of brick. With our own hands, right? Whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth. Therefore is the name of it called Babel. Right? All right. Daniel 3, verse 13 to 15. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if ye be ready that at that time ye hear the sound of the... music again. Now this is 6, right? This is the 15th chapter, 15th verse. You hear the music, you have to serve my gods, worship the golden image. When you hear the music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. But if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour in the midst of the burning fire furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? What is this last verse here? And he's challenging. Who is your God? Who is your God that who's going to deliver you out of my hands? What does hands mean prophetically? Hands. No. Persecution, actually. Yeah. Who's going to deliver you out of my persecution? Right. Hands means persecution. Deliver. What does deliver out of my, we'll go there a little bit, but here I put these three symbols. This is the symbol of the sun. The sun has these rays coming out, right? This is Shamas. This is Sin or Nana. This is the moon. And this is the eight-pointed star. The eight-pointed star is Ishtar, right? Now, this eventually it changed their names eventually. Eventually became Baal, Semiramis, and Tammuz, right? And eventually is the precursor of what we now we know becomes the adopted to become the Trinity. All right, I think we'll end here, okay? But we'll do this last verse first. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. I love this verse so much. Verse Daniel 3:16, right? Just remember John 3:16? Remember Daniel 3:16, right? We are not careful, meaning? We are not hesitant, meaning? Our mind is made up, meaning? Our character is made up. Your mind is your character, right? Your character is made up, right? So they said, you know, our mind is already made up, right? At the Sunday law, their mind is made up, actually, right? Actually, before it is even before, because their character is made manifest in the time of crisis. So it's only a test. They, at the time of that test, their character is already shown. Their characters were made up, even at the midnight cry, right?
So even before.
Yeah, we are not careful to answer thee.
Yeah.
It is not even the word will not even pass my mind. It's not even a consideration. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver. Hey, there you go. He's another deliverer. Yeah? Our God will deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver out of your thine hand, right? The hand. Right? This hand is persecution. Our God will deliver. What is the deliver? And be it not, and be if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image. That golden image is a representation of these gods. But our God is going to deliver. What is good? What is deliver? Shazab, which is no. This, remember now we're in Daniel 3. Daniel 3 is written in Aramaic. That's why this Chaldean.
Oh.
Right? It's leave or free. Free, leave or free. Who's delivered also or free themselves at the Sunday law? Daniel 11. 41 to 44. He shall enter also into the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape. Escape is what?
Delivered.
Which is also means leave, right? Leave. Also means malat. It's actually, the word is malat. They're going to escape. They're going to malat out of his hand, out of his persecution. Right? Same story. Even more Edom, Moab, and Ammon. There's three of them. Why is there three? Because this is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So, who is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego typifying? Who? The Gentiles. The Gentiles, right? And right here is the Gentiles. It's the Nethinims, right? Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel. In Daniel 1 was what? They were the priests. And in Daniel 2, Daniel was what? He was a Levite. In Daniel 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is a what? It's the Gentiles, the Nethinims. Does God have a modus operandi? Does he is you can see his workings here. It's just amazing. It's amazing.
Let's go back to the
rose. Right? The only way you're gonna understand this is foreign language. You're studying foreign language. Dark secrets. Right? So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is the Nethinims that escape Edom, Moab, and Ammon. All right. Have you thought of why Daniel is not there? Why was Daniel not in the fiery furnace?
He was a priest.
Exactly. He's not a Nethinim.
Yeah.
He's not a Nethinim. He's already sealed.
Yeah.
He's already sealed. You realize that? That makes sense now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Why was now the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego escaped because God, you know, delivered them out of the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, right? Nebuchadnezzar typifies the papacy, right? And Edom, Moab, and Ammon escape out of the hand of papacy here. Edom, Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon, right? Because the papacy will be troubled because of the tidings of the east and the tidings of the north shall trouble him, right? We know this is the papacy, mm-hmm. right? But the Edom, Moab, and Ammon are the three entities that is going to escape out of the hand of the papacy. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego typifies Edom, Moab, and Ammon. So
why is Daniel not there?
Right. So why is Daniel not in the fiery furnace? Because he's a priest. He's already sealed. He's already sealed. This is their sealing time. Their time. Their sealing time is right there. Right? That's why they're sealed. Right. So what is the tidings out of the east that troubles the papacy at the Sunday law? Out of the
east.
Oh yeah, it's absolutely.
The
right. Who comes from the north? The true king of the north. Who brings that tidings to the what? Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're going to tell, hey, we're going to sing. And we're going to sing? Sing that the true king of the north is going to come. Who's that true king of the north?
Jesus.
Right. In the meantime, there's going to be
the east.
The economy is going to sing, right? Economy gonna sing, and the ships is gonna sink because of the east wind, right?
Double.
All right. The meanings are very
clear.
Is it coming to? Is becoming clear?
Yeah. It's a secret language.
It's a secret language. I'm telling
it's
you.
Double.
This is double, triple layers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We haven't finished. I thought we're going to finish chapter 3, but I don't think we need to finish. We'll continue next week. All right. Okay, and that is... Oh, hold on. Let me put on my logo. That is the more assured word of
prophecy.
Okay.
What are you looking?